All right, thanks so much for coming and to the organizers for inviting me. Actually, this is an advertising gimmick. I'm not going to talk about functional encryption. And yes. So I did want to say that, so the only prerequisites for the talk is that you should know what a bit is, what a one-time pad is, and what the uniform distribution is. And you should be ready to ask a lot of questions if I'm speaking in a language that you do not understand. Okay. So other than that, let me start. So I'm going to start by talking about... I don't know, N-bit stream, right. So I'm going to start with the... I'm going to start with traditional encryption. So there's a sender and a receiver. This is a symmetric key setting for those who, you know, want to think more. And we think of the sender receiver as sharing a string that's drawn from the uniform distribution. So this is a private string, private in the sense that it's only known to the sender and the receiver. Okay. So what traditional encryption is about is that the sender later comes along and has some message M that it wants to transmit securely to the receiver. So an encryption scheme should allow you to lock, to essentially encrypt the message. So put the message in the box, send it to the receiver so that when the receiver has the key, this shared randomness, you'll be able to recover the message M. And for eavesdropper who can only see what's being transmitted over here and doesn't have access to this private randomness, it should learn nothing about M. Okay. So for the purpose of this talk, you can take any definition of nothing about M that you want. Semantic security is fine. The conditional distribution type definition is fine. Just full Shannon entropy type definition is fine. Just pick your favorite definition. Okay. Right. So what we know from Shannon's work is that to realize this, the sender needs to send M bits. This is both necessary and sufficient. All right. So we're going to move beyond traditional encryption. We're going to talk about something called attribute-based encryption, which was introduced, by Sahai and Waters and the work of Goel et al. The way I'm describing it is actually officially called conditional disclosure of secrets. But I'm going to use the name attribute-based encryption. All right. So there's a more fine-grained notion of public key encryption. So here, the sender, in addition to holding a message M, holds some string X. And the receiver also has some string Y. X and Y is not something that you want to keep secret, but they correspond to some kind of attributes or description about these people. All right? You don't want to keep it secret, yeah. More or less public, but not completely public, in the sense that the receiver doesn't know what X is and the sender doesn't know what Y is. So, So instead of the sender sending a message to the receiver, we're going to work with a slightly different model. The sender and the receiver will each send a message to a third party. Okay? And the requirement we want now is that this party, upon seeing these two messages, but not the private randomness, should learn M if and only if some predicate evaluates to true on X and Y. So this is some fixed predicate, universal predicate, could be equality or something else. We'll give examples of these predicates, right? So this predicate is fixed, right? And the requirement is that it should learn M if and only if the predicate is true. Okay? In particular, if it's true, it should be able to recover M from these two messages. And this, if the predicate is zero, then it should learn nothing about M. So we assume that X and Y are public, but let me first, so the question that we're interested in over here is how many bits do the sender and the receiver need to send? All right, so they correspond to? Information-theoretic security, yes. Right. So how much communication do the sender and the receiver need to send? And the number of bits that they need to send will be a function of P. So for every predicate, you potentially have a different protocol. All right. So to answer Daniel's question, right, I'm going to assume that this party knows X and Y for free. Okay? So the bits are not about, the communication we're trying to bound is not about communicating X and Y, because X and Y are set for free, but all of it is about sort of protecting M. You want to transmit M if some predicate is true, and you want to make sure that M is hidden if the predicate is false. Okay, so this is the definition of the problem. Any questions? I'll give a couple of examples, and if they're still not clear, then we can come back to the definition. All right? So we're interested in both upper and lower bounds on the number of bits in the set. Yes? I haven't given the upper bound yet. This is a general question that we're interested in. We want to know how many bits the sender and the receiver needs to send. Okay? So I'll give you a couple of examples for different predicates to give you a sense of what the protocols look like and what the upper bounds look like. right? So let's first see the simplest possible predicate, which corresponds to our traditional encryption. So the receiver just holds a bit y, and the predicate just completely disregards x and just evaluates y. In particular, if y is true, if y is 1, then the predicate is true. If y is 0, the predicate is false. Okay, and here there's a very simple protocol that corresponds to basically the one-time pad. So the shared randomness will be a one-time pad k. The sender will always send k XOR m, and the receiver will send k if the bit is true, and send bot or zero if the bit is false. Y times k is just shorthand for saying if y is 1, send k. If y is 0, don't send anything. Okay, or send 0, right? So if, in particular, if y is 1, then the receiver can XOR the two of them, recover m. And if y is 0, this reveals no information about k, so m is perfectly hidden from this, not the from this party's point of view. Right? Any questions? Okay. All right, so let's start thinking of slightly more complex predicates. Let's say the equality predicates. Yeah? So think of x and y as n-bit strings. So for the purpose of this talk, think of m as being just a single bit. Okay? So x and y are n-bit strings, and you know, you want to learn m if and only f and y are equal. All right, so here, the shared randomness will correspond to just a pairwise independent hash function. If you don't know what a pairwise independent hash function is, think of you map x to ax plus b. Okay? So the sender will send a hash of x XOR with m, and the receiver will send a hash of y. Okay? In particular, if x equals to y, then again you can just subtract the two and recover m. If x is not equal to y, then these two are independent random strings. So this essentially serves the one-time pad to completely hide m. Are there any questions so far? I do, right. This protocol doesn't use knowledge of x, so yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. Sorry? No. If you always just subtract. The requirement is only that if they are equal, you recover m. If they're not equal, there's no correctness requirement. Yeah. There's no correctness requirement. It's just that you don't learn anything. Okay, so so this is also optimal communication. By Shannon bound, you can show that you need to send m bits here and you need to send m bits here. Okay, so if you hash down to exactly m bits, then you get optimal communication. That's why you use a hash function. All right, let me give you one more example. In fact, I'm going to give you a couple more examples. This is what's called the index predicate for communication complexity. Sorry? Yes. And you can show that this is optimal. Yeah. This is basically, this is the Shannon bound for the ciphertext sign, the Shannon bound for key size. Yeah. Sorry, if x not equals to y, the adversary should learn nothing about m. We're not trying to hide x and y, though. We think of x and y as problem. Yeah, the adversary. Yeah, because let's just pretend that this guy always knows x and y. Okay. Yeah. That is inevitable. That you always leak. Yeah. We're not trying to protect x and y. We're only trying to hide m. Right, yeah. So what's non-trivial is that, this guy doesn't know why. Otherwise, you can just compute the predicate, and then if it's true, send m. If it's not true, don't send m. Yeah. So what's important is that the sender doesn't know why, the receiver doesn't know x. But this person knows both. Right. So from a communication point of view, your bound is not about trying to transmit x and y, but about just one bit of information. Right, so x and y essentially sent for free. Great, so let me give you one more example. In fact, I'm going to give you a couple more examples. This is called the index predicate in communication complexity. In cryptography, we call it broadcast encryption. For everyone else, x is an n-bit string, y is a number between 1 and n, and the predicate is true if the yth bit of x is 1, and false if the yth bit of x is 0. Okay? So what do you do? So the shared randomness now is just a bunch of one-time pads. How many one-time pads? N one-time pads. The bit length of the string x. Okay. Then, oops, now I did something wrong. Right, sorry, so there is a XOR m over here. So what the party on the left sends is basically apply a one-time pad for every bit position where x is 1, apply the one-time pad to m. Okay, and then this person will just send the one-time pad according to the index y. Now, if xi at the yth bit is true, then this one-time pad will coincide with one of the one-time pads over here, and you can recover m. And otherwise, this one-time pad over here is completely different from the rest of the one-time pads, so you don't learn m. Yeah.
Wait, so the sender sending m XOR?
Yeah, it's the sender sends ki XOR m. for all I such that xi is 1. Yeah, so the length of the message here, if you think of the message as being bits, this can be as long as n bits. This is roughly n bits. Just for one bit message, you need to say n bits, yes. Yes. Any questions? Okay, great. So I'm going to give you yet another example. So I've shown you a couple of predicates. What about, can we have general feasibility results? What if you have a general P with n bit inputs? So think of x and y as 3 n bits long. Does a protocol even exist, right? So, and if a protocol exists, how many bits do you need to send? Right? So intuitively, it seems like the sender and the receiver, from before you, even for this simple predicate, the sender seems to be sending m bits already. So if an arbitrarily complex predicate, it seems like, well, probably the sender needs to send m bits and the receiver needs to send m bits. So I'll let you think about this for a second. So there are three possibilities, right? One is that, we know how to prove a lower bound. Everybody needs to send n bits. Second possibility is that we think both parties each needs to send n bits, but we don't know how to prove such a lower bound. The third possibility is that this statement is not true. You can send less than n bits. Okay? So, I mean, I'm asking this question not because, you know, I want to test how good you are at puzzles, but I'm curious how your intuition about this kind of protocols coming from your background, information theory or whatsoever, translate into this setting. So does anyone want to venture a guess as to what the intuition says?
It's all recorded.
So it's bad. All right, so keep your answer to yourself, and I'm going to tell you what the answer is. All right. Turns out the answer is not true. I can give you a protocol where the sender sends less than n bits. I can also give you a protocol where the receiver sends less than n bits.
Can you have both?
No, not at the same time. That I don't know how to do. In fact, that is more or less impossible.
Sorry, n is the
bit length of x and y. Think of m as always one bit.
Okay.
So we're trying to quantify complexity as a function of the predicate, quote unquote.
Why are you not thinking about the pair by putting it on at the same time?
I have different protocols with different trade-offs for communication.
But you don't want the pair total whatever, length one, length two, length of pair characterization.
Sorry?
You don't want to characterize the pair of length?
You do care about the pair of length. I'm also care about the exact trade-offs. What kind of trade-offs can you get? Yes. Yes, we also want to do that. For every P, I want to give you the best bound you can get. Yeah. But let's first make sure that there even exists a solution for all P. Right? Does that make sense?
Is there something that says that there is a P which needs a super constant?
No, great. Let's do upper bounds for now. No? Okay. Not really, actually. I'll come to that. I just want to give you a sense, a couple of examples of upper bounds before we talk about lower bounds. Okay, so let me give you an upper bound for this. Yeah, in fact, you can have, here's a protocol where the receiver only sends one bit. Okay, this is sort of a variant of the index protocol that I just saw. So how does it work? The shared randomness is a bunch of 2 to the n one-time pairs. There's a one-time pair for every possible input. Think of x and y as being n-bit strings. Yeah, so there are 2 to the n one-time pairs. Okay, so the receiver will just send the one-time pair corresponding to its input. The receiver will look at its x, goes through all the y prime that makes the x true, collect all of those one-time pairs, and use those one-time pairs to encrypt the message x. Okay, so correctness is basically the same as the index protocol. If there exists some y for which the protocol is true, for which p of x y is true, then this y would be with coincide with one of the one-time pairs over here, and then you recover m. We assume that the receiver always knows x and y. This party doesn't have a name. This party always knows x and y. Right? So then I know which one-time pair, which ciphertext to use to cancel it out. Sorry?
Why do you call that part?
I don't know, because I put it the other way. No, only the sender has M. But you can, that's a generic transformation. You may assume they're symmetric. Okay. Any question why this protocol satisfies correctness that you can recover M? Okay, security just basically follows from the fact that if the predicate is false, this one-time pet and all of these one-time pets over here are disjoint. Right? Because you're only sending one-time pets corresponding to Y that makes the X true.
So this is just a reduction to your earlier index?
It's actually the truth table reduction to index, yes. Okay?
So,
the receiver just sent one.
Maybe I missed
yes.
Like the first slide. But right. Is there a reason you're separating the communication that is needed to set up the key from the communication?
Oh, why do I want to separate the two communication? Right, right. So first of all, think of it as a generally interesting question to understand the exact trade-offs. The way we're interested in it is that in the context of ABE, this corresponds to the length of the ciphertext, this corresponds to the length of the secret key. So you can have schemes that have different trade-offs between ciphertext sizes and secret key sizes. So we want to understand the trade-off. You know, you want schemes where maybe the ciphertext have constant size. Maybe in some application you want schemes where the secret key have constant size. And then instead of trying to optimize the sum of the two. Okay. Are there any other questions? Right. Okay. So this is the protocol where the receiver sends one bit. Let me show you the protocol where the sender sends one bit. Okay. So that's sort of the reflection of the previous protocol. So the sender just uses X to pick a one-time pet and sends it to M. Okay? And the receiver sends all one-time pets correspond to X that makes its predicate true. Okay? So So that's that. Any questions so far? So this gives you a protocol where the so we now have a protocol where the receiver sends one bit. We also have a protocol where the sender sends one bit. You can also do a balancing thing. Where the sender sends t bits and the receiver sends 2 to the n over t bits. You basically just chop up the 2 to the n space into t blocks and then you run the two protocols. So in particular, you can get total communication 2 to the n over 2.
Okay, what is the difference between the sender and receiver?
In terms of applications?
In your model, only the sender has a message.
Only the sender has a message. But that's without loss of generality. You can pay one more bit and then just do like a. The sender has the message and the receiver doesn't. Yeah. Are there any other questions? Okay, great. So that gives us a bunch of upper bounds. I want to mention one more upper bound, which I'm not going to prove, namely that for NC1 formula, so this you can think of this as branching programs or Boolean formulas. Actually, NC1 circuits log that formula, then we have an upper bound saying that if you have a formula of size S, then the sender sends S bits and the receiver sends S bits. Okay, so for sufficiently, to answer your question, for sufficiently simple functions, but by simple, I mean the circuit complexity, quote unquote, we have polynomial communication. Right? Note that the generic solution is exponential communication. Any questions? Any question what the object is? All right, so our main result is basically to prove a lower bound communication.
So it's exactly S bits or order S bits?
I think you can get to exactly S, but order S for sure. I'm not requiring. Wait, let me first say what I wanted to say. I didn't say that I'm assuming asymptotic notation for background, so I can't use order notation, but what's the intuition for why S bits is sufficient or necessary?
Sufficient,
you do secret sharing. Yeah. So basically for every gate in the formula, you send one bit. Actually, I think it's 2F. Okay, after constants, multiplicative constants, and possibly additive constants. Yeah. So our main result, this is joint work with my PhD student Roma and your Danish Karenidis, who's in Paris but not in Paris. Our main result is lower bound communication. Okay. Before I say exactly what the lower bound is, let me first say that, let me give you an example of our lower bounds for specific functions. So for index, which is the one where you hold some position and want to know whether the ith bit is true, we basically get tight lower bounds. Right? We can show that the product of the communication is at least n for a certain range of parameters. And this is tight, that's the matching upper bound. Okay. Prefix is also true. Prefix is the functionality where it's the predicate where x is an n-bit string and you want to know whether y is a string of length at most n bits and whether y is a prefix of x. Okay, there we have the same lower bound and it's tight, up to some caveat which I'll describe at the end of the talk.
Wait, so does it show that there exists a Boolean function which means square root n to the n over 2 bits?
This implies that there exists a Boolean function that needs n over 2, square n bits, yeah. Oh, yeah, you can do a reduction and that gives you also, yeah. That's a catch, the lower bound is only for linear protocols. So I'll describe the catch at the end. You can do a reduction. If you violate this bound, then you violate the other bound.
It's the exact same relationship as, yes, as what you showed before between general functions and effects, right?
You can think of general Boolean function as a truth table, then it's basically a vector of length 2 to the n.
You're talking about the upper bound or the lower bound?
Lower bound.
Lower bound.
What's k functions? Yeah.
It's not countable.
Let's take that question offline. You know? No, that's good. No, but let's take that question offline. Okay. There's a catch. This is only for restricted class of protocols. I'll come back to the catch at the end of the talk. But reasonable catch. Yeah. Okay. And then for inner products, this is a predicate that takes n-bit strings and check whether the inner product mod 2 is 0 or 1. We show that if one party sends constant number of bits, the other party needs to send n bits. Okay, and vice versa. And both of these bounds are also tight. You can have a protocol where one party sends constant number of bits, the other party sends a linear number of bits, and vice versa. And we show that this is tight. Okay? Yes. I will give you a general lower bound for which these are special cases.
Okay.
Are there any questions so far? About the statement? I'm not telling you what the general statement is. I'm just giving you examples of the lower bounds, which are tight.
So this lower bound is for arbitrary
protocols? No, it's actually for linear protocols.
So what do you mean by linear protocols?
I'll explain at the end. Our techniques are fairly general. You get a logarithmic. There's a gap between general protocols and linear protocols. There's an exponential gap for the lower bounds.
I see. So there is a statement for general.
We have a statement which is exponentially smaller.
Lower bounds log n.
Yeah. Which is already non-trivial because the secret is only 1 bit long.
Yeah.
I'll come back to four of those who didn't catch that, I'll come back to that at the end of the talk. Okay. The technique is fairly general. I want to emphasize on the technique. Alright? So any questions about statements? All right, so let me tell you our proof strategy. We're going to rely on a well-studied area in complexity theory called communication complexity. Okay? Let me tell you what communication complexity is about. You have Alice and Bob. They possibly share some randomness, say uniformly random randomness. Alice holds X, Bob holds Y. They both send a message to a third party. And the goal of the third party is to learn P of XY. So there's no secrecy requirement. The goal of this party is just to compute P of x, y. Right? Now, the main difference between here and here is that this party doesn't know x and y. Okay? So what communication complexity is about is how many bits does Alice need to send about x, how many bits does Bob need to send about y in order to compute P of x, y. Okay? I want to emphasize here that communication complexity is really about how many bits you need to send about x and y, whereas in our setting, x and y are for free. Okay, so they look related, but they are qualitatively very different problems. So this is a well-studied problem. For instance, so people prove lower bounds for different predicates P. In particular, for the index predicate that I talked about, the lower bound is tight. We have a tight lower bound. Basically, Alice needs to send all of its string, all n bits, and Bob needs to send basically all of its input, which is log n bits, because it's the index between one and n. Okay? Again, maybe it's minus constant or omega log n. That's the nice about, yes? No. Bob only knows Y, Alice only knows X in communication complexity.
That's
the one-way communication complexity. I want you to think in this model where a third party wants to compute.
The
upper bound or the lower bound? Yeah.
One-sided
communication. Yeah. One-way communication. Yeah. So if you know communication complexity, this is the one-way communication. The other one is the one-way communication. Okay. So basically, for different predicates, people have characterized how many bits exactly you need to send. Okay, well, I'm just going to use those bounds. All right, so I'm going to try to relate now how many bits you need to send here to communication complexity over here. Right. Any questions? In particular, I want to take lower bounds in, So in particular, I want to take lower bounds in communication complexity and transfer it to lower bounds in our setting. Okay, what does it mean to transfer lower bounds? It means I give an upper bound, right? It means I want to show, I want to take any protocol here and transform it into a protocol here so that the communication doesn't blow up by too much, so that whatever lower bounds here gives you a lower bound over here. Okay? Any questions? All right. So so let's go back to the model that we were trying to prove lower bounds for. So I'm going to call this message MS, call this message MR. I want to emphasize here that you know X and Y here. So this is very different from here where you don't know X and Y. Yeah? And remember, the we say that you learn M if only P of X, Y is 1. I want to be a bit more precise. I'm going to call this the function that you compute to recover M, the reconstruction function. Okay? So correctness say that that's reconstruction function that takes X and Y and the two messages that you get and output something. Right? In particular, if the predicate is true, the reconstruction function should output M. All right, I'm going to use the reconstruction function over here. Any questions? All right, so here's our first idea. Yeah? Just take the message over here and copy them over here. Right? So Alice was compute whatever it was computing from before, but also send his message M. So think of Alice as, you know, picking a random M and then computing this message over here with respect to X and M. Okay? And Bob will just compute whatever it computes over there. Right? And how does this party try to recover the P of XY, it's going to run the reconstruction function. And if it outputs, runs the reconstruction function on this message and this message, if output this M over here, say the predicate is true. And if it outputs something different, say that the predicate is false. Let's just pretend you can run. Let's just pretend you can do it for now, yeah? So, right, so the... You are ahead. Don't do this to me, right? Let's just pretend that, you know, pick a random X, Y, let's say, all right? So the claim is that this protocol satisfies correctness. Okay? In fact, if you understand what they are saying, you know, I'm going to ignore you. Yeah? The people who are supposed to follow the talk should not understand what John was asking. So I'm going to claim that the protocol works, right? Because if the predicate is true, obviously you will recover M. And if the predicate is false, you know, we know by privacy that these two messages don't tell you anything about M, so the probability that you recover the right M is probably only 1/2. Right? So you have perfect completeness and soundness 1/2. Right? So if this is true, then what does it mean? That means that the length of this message plus 1 to correspond to M is greater than or equals to the communication complexity of the predicate. Because this is a protocol that satisfies the requirement. Yeah? Right. Turn out this is false. For the inner product predicate, we have upper bound for which the left hand side is n plus 1, and for which you can prove a lower bound of 2n on the right hand side. Okay? So this statement is false. There exists a. Suppose this protocol satisfies correctness, you get this. Sorry, what?
Not only is the proof, the claim proof make no sense at all, but the theorem itself is also
right.
Is this entire thing like a plausible sounding but in fact bad idea of how to prove this? Is that what you're trying to say?
But this is the first idea. The first idea, it's not bad. It doesn't work. The fact that it doesn't work doesn't mean it's bad. Right? We shouldn't judge. It's not a bad idea. It's just an idea that doesn't work.
It's an idea that doesn't work.
Doesn't mean that it's bad.
Okay, so it's a good idea that
it's bad. Exactly, yes. Then you need a second idea, right? So are there any questions why it's false? So I'm not going to show you why it's false, but the reason it's false is that there's a predicate for which left hand side is n plus 1, right hand side is 2n. Right? And what now I can tell you why it's false. And I can understand, I can answer John's question, right? The reason is, right, to run this recourse. What can I do? I say that the only requirements are bits, uniform distribution, and one-time pair. If you happen to know more, it's not my fault, right? All right, so the reason why this statement is false is that, right, this algorithm is not well-defined. Yeah? It's not well-defined. Because to run the reconstruction algorithm, I need to feed in an X and a Y. Right? And that's really important because that's crucially the difference between this setting here and this setting over here. Right? So the reason it's false is that the protocol is not well-defined. So what does it mean by I run this? So the natural thing to do is to try all possible XYs that are true. Right? And try to, and then run this reconstruction algorithm with those XY. Check whether you recover M. If there exists a XY that's true, and you recover M, then you output 1. Otherwise, you output 0. Okay? This will give you correctness. As in, when X and Y is true, you will output M because you will find the X and the Y. And turns out, if X and Y is false, you could also possibly output true. Right? Because there may be some strange looking, there are so many X, Y's that are true, one of them, each of them with probability 1/2 will give you this M. There are possibly exponential number of yes instances, so you know eventually it will hit one that will recover M for you.
You made M very large.
Sorry?
You made M very large.
Yeah, right. But then now I want M to be 1 bit, right? If you make M very large, then you know the lower bound, you want a lower bound that doesn't come from M being long. Any questions? So the problem is this issue of
suggest other good ideas?
You want to suggest other good ideas? Yeah. You want to suggest other good ideas? Okay. So you know, and then you think about this, you're like, all right, so what's wrong with this? You have this thing that is false. This is m plus 1 and 2n. So clearly, the right solution to this is try to patch this gap, right? You try to somehow add n bits over here. This statement is false. So there exists the upper bound as n plus 1, the lower bound is 2n, which then means that this protocol fails because it doesn't send enough bits. You want to send an extra n bits, then you can bridge the gap between the lower bound and the upper bound. Right? So we're trying this for a very, very long time, and then it doesn't work. So now it doesn't work. And then the... Now you need a second good idea, and then the third one is the nice one. And you can tell me whether you think the third one is the nice one. So at this point, you know, I was talking to Amos, I was visiting Israel, and you know, he basically gave me a summary of the talk that he gave this morning. And at one point he said, you know, lower bounds are always about counting arguments for secret sharing. You need to be able to count, right? So somehow you want to be able to count. So that's what we're going to do. Yeah? We're going to use some sort of a counting argument. So what I'm going to do, so the second good idea is the following. Yeah? The second good idea, actually, hindsight is obvious, a priori is not obvious. Because if you are trying to bridge these n gaps, what you will think about is trying to send a bit more information. Right? And that's not what we're going to do. We're going to run many copies of the protocol. Okay? By n, yeah. All right? So let's run many copies of the protocol. This is the second idea. Right? So let's run n copies of the protocol and see what n we can get. If n is something like, you know, square root n is still square root of little n, you still get a square root lower bound, so it's still non-trivial. Yeah? Getting anything super constant is already non-trivial. Yeah? So if n is something like square root n, you're still fine. Right? So let's run n copies. Okay. What does running n copies mean? I'm going to run independent copies of the basic protocol n times. Right. So how am I going to fix this predicate? I'm going to do the following. I'm going to enumerate again over all yes instances, and I'm going to run the reconstruction algorithm with the same x y. And if on all of these n copies I recover the same the correct message every time on all n copies, I output true. Right. If on some copy I get the wrong answer, I output false. Okay. The copies are independent randomness, yeah. Independent message M, independent randomness, right? So the problem with the previous thing is that, you know, we know that for one copy, there's a probability 1/2 of being, if it's false, there's a probability 1/2 of getting caught. So if you run N copies, if you are false, then the probability of being caught is 2 to the minus N, right? of not being caught is 2 to the minus n, right? And for the yes instance, you don't have to worry. You always once you find the correct XY, you are set. Okay? Second idea, right? So this is the second idea. Yeah, you're way ahead. You give no incentive for giving her. No. Okay, right. So how big does n need to be? So you basically want to do a union bound, right? So the number of copies you need is log of the number of possible things that you're enumerating over. Okay, so the number of copies you need is log of the number of yes instances. Right. So if you set n to be log of the number of yes instances, you can afford to take a union bound over all yes instances. Okay? Right. So come back to Vinod's point. Let's calculate this quantity over here. In general, your number of yes instances could be 2 to the n. Right? This is the predicate NB inputs. Roughly half is true and roughly half is false. So it could be as large as 2 to the n. In fact, think of it as roughly 2 to the n. Can be even bigger, but at least something like 2 to the n. Yeah, it's actually 2 to the 2n, depending. But roughly 2 to the n exponential. Okay, and your communication complexity can never be more than n. Because in communication complexity, you can always send x and send y. So you can never get anything more than n. Right? So now, this quantity over here, this n, which is log of 2 to the n, is at least n. The right-hand side is at most n. So you cannot get any lower bounds better than constant. Yeah, does that make sense? So now we're sort of stuck, right? Are there any questions? Oh, good, okay. Really? Okay. All right, now I'm gonna give you the third, okay. I'm gonna give you the third idea and then, sorry, this is the third one is the magic. Right? So I'm not going to enumerate over all x and y anymore. Okay, enumerating over all x and y is a bad idea because there are many possible x and y. Okay? I'm going to enumerate over all reconstruction functions, which a priori sounds ridiculous, but I'm going to enumerate over all reconstruction functions with x and y hardwired into it. I'm going to enumerate over all functions with x and y hardwired into it. Because this is a function. If x and y are fixed, this is a function from this message and this message to m.
So you're saying the number of distinct pairs x, y might be large, but there could be particular schemes for which distinct pairs are distinct pairs, and so you could have
the many x and y.
The number is actually much lower.
Yes, exactly. The idea, and what turns out to be the case, is that for many x and y, they are going to hit, they are going to be the same reconstruction function. Sorry? Exactly, right? So why does this even work, right? So I'm going to enumerate over all reconstruction functions. So in particular, I'm going to enumerate all functions that takes a message of length ms times a message of length mr and sends to a message of length 0. Yeah, that's what I mean by enumerating over all functions. In particular, for correctness, I take the function that for the fixed x and y hardwired into the function. Okay, are there any questions? What I mean? Okay, and then again, I do all the copies. Right. So now, instead of taking log of number of yes instances, I just need to do log of the number of reconstruction functions. Right. Now, the key observation here is that while the number of yes instances depends on n, the number of reconstruction functions doesn't depend on n. It only depends on the communication of the protocol. Right? So in particular, if let's say we just want to prove constant lower bounds, the reconstruction function is a function from a constant size domain to a constant size output. So the number of functions is constant. Right? So it's much better than enumerator over all x and y. Right. So more generally, right, how big is this number over here? Right. So this is a function from this domain to this domain. I want to calculate log of the number of functions. I just need to count how many bits I need to specify the function. Okay? To specify the function, I just need to specify its output on all possible inputs. So the number of possible inputs is 2 to the ms plus mr. So log of the reconstruction function is at most 2 to the ms plus mr. So 2 to the total communication. Okay. So the nice thing now is that this bound doesn't depend on n. So if you plug this in over here, then you get a lower bound of the chi logarithmic of the communication complexity. Okay. So this is a general lower bound for all reconstruction functions. In particular, for most interesting predicate, this gives you a log n lower bound, which is already much better than you know, no lower bound. Yeah. Yes, that's exactly what I'm going to say next. Yeah. So in particular, for all non-upper bounds, the reconstruction function is linear. Okay. So if the function is linear, then you don't need an exponential number of bits. You're essentially just specifying coefficients. So the number of bits you need is just ms plus mr. And then if you plug this in over here, you get a square root n bound. Square root communication complexity bound. All right. Yes? That's true. In general, you don't want the lower bound to depend on the. You want the lower bound to apply to one bit messages in some sense, right? Because somehow the one bit is the when you always have a trivial lower bound, which is the length of the message. Right? So in this case, if the message is slightly longer, you don't save that much. I think you save maybe even log n factor. I'm not sure. I don't know offhand. Let's just focus on one bit messages for now. Let me just say one or. You have this, and then you multiply by this, so you do the number communication copies of each of the copy you send. Yeah. Okay, so that's lower bound. So let me just say what I mean by reconstruction function being linear. I mean linear in the messages, which is sort of the same as the linear for linear in the messages, which is sort of standard requirement for many MPC type applications. In particular, in many applications, the messages from the sender and the receiver are linear in the shared randomness. And you can show that for protocols where the sender and the receiver messages are linear in the shared randomness, your reconstruction function is also linear. Yeah? So this is a fairly general. It captures both protocols where the protocol computation is linear. It also captures linear reconstruction. Yeah. Adam, ask the question, please. Yeah.
Well, I was just going to ask. So the square root comes from the fact that you're resampling kind of these n copies are totally independent. Can you use these sort of tricks from amplification to like?
So what the random efficient amplification seems to allow you to do is to reduce the amount of randomness you need to sample these instances. But then after that, you still need to run the entire. You still need to run n copies. It's just that these n copies are sampled with lower amount of number, fewer number of bits. Yeah, I don't know how to compress. We know that it's tight for some predicates. So if you have some way to compress, it must depend crucially on the predicates. No. That is sufficient. But in particular, it is true if you are a linear function of the messages. Yeah. And I have no a priori reason to define linear except from linear.
In it's a small circuit, then again.
Yes, but you have to think very carefully, though. It is tempting to think about, you know. Yeah. So for instance, even this reconstruction could be a linear time algorithm. And then if your messages are logarithmic bits long, reconstruction now is the exponential sine circuit. Because when I talk about linear, I'm talking about as a function of the length of these messages.
So once you fix xy, the circuit for given that takes a simple MR.
It's the linear in the, yeah. Yeah, smooshing is fine, yeah. Linear is a natural requirement. We don't have any, we essentially don't have examples that are not linear. I'll come back to that in a second. A question? For computing? Yes. Our lower bound is extremely robust. So if you have a gap, the gap translates directly to the gap for communication complexity. And the communication complexity, you have lower bounds for errors. Yeah. 5 minutes. OK, great. What is the
function for risk the square root is tight?
Index. You have P n over T, so. It's actually, I mean, if you compare carefully, it's more like MS times this thing is greater or equal to communication. So, yeah, any questions? Okay, conclusion. Today I talked about communication complexity of attribute-based encryption. A bunch of really very interesting questions, and we really hope that you know, more people will think about these questions, including people from the information theory community. Let me describe a couple of open questions. The first is to understand the power of nonlinear reconstruction. So our lower bound is only for, our lower bound is tight for linear reconstruction. Most known upper bounds are linear, but what about nonlinear? Okay. So this exponential gap also happens in secret sharing. So, So to understand the power of nonlinear reconstruction, by which I mean both upper bounds and lower bounds. Right? Upper bound in the sense that can you come up with some special predicate where with nonlinear reconstruction you can do something really cool. Right? And lower bound, I guess, to extend our lower bounds beyond, to get stronger lower bounds for nonlinear reconstruction. So I claim that most of the known upper bounds are linear. In particular, all the protocols I showed you are linear. But there's been examples recently of protocols with nonlinear reconstruction. This is the work of Bimal Ishai and Vinod and Prashant. So their results were stated in the language of secret sharing. But I'm going to say that they are wrong. You should think of their results as giving upper bounds for attribute-based encryption, for CDS. It's much cleaner. Because you do graph isomorphism, you have to think about bits and shares and parties. It doesn't make sense. Sorry?
I'm formalized
with the language of secret sharing. Yeah, when I saw Amos, the first thing he said was that this is a question about secret sharing with special access structures. And you have to worry about n parties. So where are your n parties? Your language is about two numbers. Are they the product, the QR or non-QR? You're giving two graphs. Are they isomorphic or non-isomorphic? Now you have to somehow decompose this into n parties. Right, yeah. Okay, let's take that part online. Also, another interesting question is to get tight bounds for inner products. So for inner product, we have tight bounds when one of sides is constant communication. But you know, for the intermediate ranges, even for linear protocols, our bound is like a square root of the right bound. So the open problem here is to close that quadratic gap. Even for linear function, it would be very interesting. This inner product is the one that causes the n plus 1 to n thing that falsified the first try. Yeah? The third is to prove lower bounds for multi-bit secrets. So for multi-bit secrets, it's easy to prove a lower bound of the kind, the bit length of the secret. We can also prove lower bounds that relates to the predicate. But it seems like the right lower bound should be something like n times the bit length of the secrets, right? And there, our techniques don't work. But as I learned from Amos today, there are contexts in secret sharing where we can prove bounds of the kind number of parties times bit length of the secret. So, so there's some cause for optimism that this problem might be solvable. That's a very good question. So, question: can we use communication complexity lower bounds in a non-black box way? We tried for inner product because the protocol that we get for our reduction, the communication complexity protocol has a certain structure. It's like many copies of some local kind of computation. So you can imagine you can prove higher lower bounds for a restricted communication complexity models and close that quadratic gap. So we tried, but we didn't try very hard. So we don't know the answer. Offhand, I don't know what the answer. I think if you made up some model, I think you can make up some model for which we don't have an upper bound that beats our conjecture lower bound. So. Right, possibly, but this is randomized communication complexity, so I think most of the lower bounds are not like partition number type things. But the lower bounds, let's say for index, is based on like mutual information or something. So it's ripe for information theory techniques. Sorry? Randomized one-way communication, yeah. Randomized. Deterministic, you can do the chromatic rectangle. But I think randomized, we don't know how to do the rectangle thing. But I'm not sure. Okay, right. Yeah, information complexity can work, right. So this is the perfect question for people working on information theory.
I guess since the XMI unknown to this guy, M is just one bit, might be hard to use in
information
complexity.
Well, you have to do it in slightly non-black box way for sure. Yeah, but using our technique, you cannot prove,
right.
More or less you cannot. That is also true, yeah. FKN lower bound, I think, is only for input length, right? How much bigger, constant bigger?
Yeah.
I mean, something that depends on the complexity of the function kind of bound, we don't really know.
And they program, there exists a function.
Sorry?
They are doing existential.
Right, yeah. But it's still sort of linear in the input length, right? Yeah, somehow going higher than that is.